Doctor Who, The Time Meddler by Nigel Robinson. Read by Peter Purves. Prologue. The young man in the astronaut's uniform fell to the jungle floor with a sickening thud. For a few dazed moments, he lay there motionless, unaware of the destruction all about him. Then he picked himself up and looked around. Towering 1,500 feet above him, the city was ablaze. Even down here at the foot of one of the hundreds of massive stilts which supported the city, the heat was intolerable, almost a physical force. The air was heavy with the cloying stench of burning flesh and molten metal. Over the roar of the flames as they ripped along the city's walkways, he could hear the sound of battle still raging high above him. It was a battle he knew neither side could win. Neither the mechanoids, robotic guardians of the city, nor the strange alien creatures who had come to this planet in search of four mysterious space travelers. He shielded his eyes as the city flashed a dazzling incandescent white. Instinctively, he clutched to his chest the panda bear mascot, which he held tightly in his arms. The city was in its final death agonies. He would need all the luck in the world if he was to escape the inevitable conflagration, when the metal supports would finally give way and bring the city crashing down to the ground. He turned to run, beating a way through the jungle, furiously fighting off the strange fungoid growths which reached out their long barbed tendrils towards him. Unearthly sounds seemed to echo from the undergrowth, but whether they were the frightened cries of wild beasts or the product of his own fevered imagination, he neither knew nor cared. He had little idea where he was heading for. All he knew was that he had to find the four travelers who had escaped the city shortly before him. Frantically, he called out their names. Doctor! Vicky! Ian! Barbara! But his voice was soon swallowed up in the sound of battle behind him. He ran for what seemed like hours until he reached the small clearing in the jungle. His eyes were wild with panic and his exertions had made him weak. But silhouetted in the searing light from the burning city, he could make out two oblong shapes. They seemed totally out of place in their jungle surroundings. They stood, silent and forbidding, like two monoliths fashioned by an ancient and forgotten race. He stumbled towards the nearest one and noted, with some confusion, that it appeared to be a large blue box. Like a medieval pilgrim seeking sanctuary, he began to pound on the double doors at the front of the object. To his surprise, they yielded to his touch, and he fell through the open doorway. The light from within stabbed painfully into his weakened eyes, and the world began to spin sickeningly around him. His tired brain tried in vain to comprehend the sight before him. For a long time, he knew nothing more. But just before he passed out, he recalled the strange legend he'd seen above the doorway. The words seemed somehow familiar and oddly reassuring. Police. Public. Call. Box. Chapter 1. The Watcher. The white-haired old man hovered intently over the control console and flexed his long, bony fingers, making delicate adjustments to one of the six instrument panels before him. As he eased levers into place, his sharp blue eyes flickered over the display of flashing lights and gauges, checking each and every motion of the machine. From time to time, he would glance at the central glass column as it rose and fell with assured regularity. Pleased with his programming, he gave a snort of self-satisfaction.
Ah, there you are, Chesterton. Ah, the TARDIS is functioning perfectly.
His voice tailed off as he realized his mistake. The young girl at the opposite end of the chamber smiled at him affectionately and gently shook her head.
Yeah, of course. They're gone now, the old man flustered.
An uncomfortable silence fell over the control room as he turned his attention once more to the central console in an attempt to cover up his embarrassment at the mistake. His companion was a wide-eyed young girl dressed in a loose-fitting smock and black trousers. Little more than 5 feet tall, she possessed elfin good looks and a mischievous little girl smile. In total contrast to her futuristic surroundings, she was sitting in a splendid Louis XIV chair, idly flipping through the pages of a book. After a few minutes, she tossed the book to the ground with a bored sigh and stood up. The TARDIS was quiet and far too empty. The doctor wasn't helping things either, she decided, what with all this brooding and a face as long as a mile. Still, it must have been quite a wrench for the old man. Ian and Barbara had been the doctor's companions for a long time, and when they had found a way to return to their proper time and space, the doctor must have felt their loss very deeply. She wondered how long it had been since she and the doctor had sent Ian and Barbara on their way back to Earth and left the planet Mechanus. Hours? Days? It was a funny thing, but in the TARDIS you didn't seem to notice the passing of time. The only thing which gave any indication of its passage was the doctor's magnificent ormolu clock, which ticked its own way through the timelessness of eternity. And it had stopped. Clicking her tongue in irritation, she crossed over to the clock and set its pendulum in motion again. Odd how a little thing like that now seemed so important. Still, the ticking of a clock did give some sort of framework, if only a psychological one, to their lives on board the TARDIS. And anyway, it was something to do. She sighed. "I shall miss them, Doctor," she said, breaking the silence. The Doctor looked up from his work. "Who?" he asked, with affected disinterest. He knew perfectly well who Vicky was talking about. "Ian and Barbara, of course," she replied with an understanding smile. "Oh, them, yes, I shall miss them too." There was a tone of regret in his voice. "First Susan, and now them." He made a brief check of the readouts from the TARDIS computer and then wandered over to the chair Vicky had recently vacated. Easing himself into it, he beckoned her over.
Come here, my dear, I'd like to talk to you."
"What about the controls?"
They're already set. We'll be landing shortly."
Vicky came over and sat down on the floor at the doctor's feet. She gazed up into his face as an adoring niece would do to her favourite uncle.
"Their decision to leave certainly surprised me," he admitted. "It shouldn't have, of course. It was quite obvious that they intended to take the first opportunity of going back to their own time."
"Well, they weren't getting any younger, were they?" Vicky said wickedly. The doctor's eyes widened with mock horror.
"It's lucky they're not here to hear you say that," he chided her good-naturedly. "Good grief! If you think they're old, what do you think of me?"
Vicky blushed at her faux pas.
"Well, you're different, Doctor," she said. "And anyway, we might land in their time one day and we'll be able to talk over old times."
"Yes, perhaps, Vicky. Perhaps."
The doctor smiled and ruffled the girl's hair. He was touched by Vicky's unquestioning faith in him. But if he were to be truthful to himself, he would have to admit that the chance of his ever meeting his old friends again was highly unlikely. The TARDIS very rarely landed anywhere it was supposed to. Not that it mattered much to the doctor. The universe was so full of wonders that there was no need to travel with a fixed destination in mind. But just occasionally, he thought, it would be nice to pilot the TARDIS to a landing of his own choice. Perhaps even visit Susan, his granddaughter. Vicky recognised the signs that the doctor was becoming morose again. "Anyway, it's done now," she chirped up and deftly changed the subject. "I wonder where the TARDIS will take us next."
"Yes, yes, it's done now," sighed the doctor. "But I must admit I'm left with one small worry. You know, I wouldn't mind seeing..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.